Burberry, Spring 2018. Tom Jameson for the New York Times, London. On Friday morning, a crude bucket bomb was detonated in the Parsons Green subway station, injuring at least 30 and sowing chaos in London. The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attack, and by the day's end, the threat level in Britain had been raised to critical, indicating another attack could be expected imminently. Meanwhile, from around the world, retailers, editors, journalists and photographers were arriving. It was the first full day of London Fashion Week. For those who had descended on the city to see several days' worth of runway shows, the contrast was jarring. Fashion Week may represent billions of dollars of business, but it is, on its face, an institutional celebration of fantasy as intrusions of the real go. Few come harder and more frightening than a terrorist attack and the imminent possibility of another. It is an impossible request that fashion shows measure up to the horror, but likewise impossible to ignore the confluence. At the very least, it's hard to focus on skirt lengths in the midst of an international incident. Molly Goddard, Spring 2018. Neil, a European press photo agency, still in a city on edge, with a shrug and a defiant sigh, London Fashion Week kept calm and carried on. Bearer, like her standard bearer for the message, was Sadiq Khan, London's charismatic mayor, sitting front row Saturday at Molly Goddard's show. "The key message I have, not just for Londoners, but for those from around the world, is we will carry on being the resilient city that we are," Mr. Khan said. "It's really important that we show business as usual rather than allow terrorists to disrupt our way of life and stop us doing what we're doing. It's really important that we demonstrate our confidence and that we show the world London is open." He ticked off the major brands that had come to London to show Tommy Hilfiger, Emporio Armani and the rising young guard that is bubbling up here, and pronounced, bullishly, "This season's London Fashion Week, I think, is the best ever." But when Ms. Goddard's first model, Edie Campbell, came tramping down the runway in a puff-skirted white cotton frock and motorcycle boots, with glass of champagne in hand and a cigarette in mouth, you thought, well, maybe SHE's on to something, too. It was noon, after all. What is there to do in the face of uncertainty but slug back the bubbly and get on with it? Somewhere between despair and willful ignorance is nonchalance, and Ms. Goddard, one of the city's rising talents, christened with her 2016 British Fashion Award, a star for today, forget a future star, Mr. Khan said as he ducked backstage after the show to make her acquaintance, delivered it. Ms. Goddard made her name in maximalist tutu dresses, the bigger the better, a confectioner in tulle. It was encouraging here to find her stripping off some of the froth and experimenting with plainer stuff like smocked cotton, still rakishly skewed and often inflated to ballooning proportions. "I wanted to slow it down and have a bit of fun with it, I suppose," she said. J.W. Anderson, Spring 2018. Tom Jameson for the New York Times. It lent a bit of backbone without sacrificing Ms. Goddard's cheerful levity. "In a time of deadly seriousness, you can go leaden and you can go light." That spirit animated several of the initial London collections, which did more with less. Jonathan Anderson, JW on his label, is one of the city's thinkiest designers, sometimes. To his detriment, he makes merry mashing up disparate elements which sometimes resolve themselves and sometimes don't, as he opines for those who arrive to cover his collections on the philosophical underpinnings in paragraph-length soliloquies. But his process is one of wax and wane, and this season, he was in a pared-back mode, one that felt right. He spoke of keeping the collection grounded, and it literally was. Nearly every look was shown with a flat pair of sneaker boots. But it was grounded, too, in its fabrics and shapes. There were some nods to his customary esotericism, like the stitched bra-cup details on many of the looks, but the loose dresses, flared skirts and baggy trousers had a casual ease and a strength in the simplicity, all the more so given that the reigning trend in fashion is for over-the-top magpie magnificence. Mr. Anderson estimated that 80% of the collection came in sweatshirt jersey. The loose pants and tops that bore his J.W. Anderson logo were made at an Irish factory that produces tea towels. "I think sometimes you have to take off the veneer and go back to basics," he said. "Go back to things that you know and things that you can use." In place of his usual show setting, with tight rows and claustrophobic intensity, Mr. Anderson knocked down the walls and set his models walking in the round. "Everything comes back round," he said. No matter how hysterical things become, everything will always come round. Things had become hysterical at Burberry, the last major show Saturday, which found anti-fur activists outside its doors screaming shame as staff members greeted guests with rictus grins and durable British politesse. Actually, with the exception of some shearling pieces, all the fur in the collection was faux. Christopher Bailey, Burberry's chief creative officer, had wanted to be a bit more honest, a bit less polished, he said, and it seemed, inadvertently, that he had gotten his wish. But everything had come back round again, too. Mr. Bailey staged the show in a former courthouse, alongside an exhibition showcasing more than 30 photographers, a glass held up to the British national character called Here We Are. Curated by Mr. Bailey, Lucy Kumara Moore, director of Claire de Rouen Books, and the photographer Alistair McClellan, it will be open to the public until October. 1. Here We Are spans classes and eras, Tatlerite Society portraits by Davith Jones alongside working class Mancunians by Shirley Baker, and so, too, does Burberry, whose checks have been embraced by chavs and peers alike. That's a point Mr. Bailey seemed keen to underline. Throughout the 20th century, Burberry has been there. If it has lost its way a bit lately, one photographer in particular seemed to point to a possible new direction, Goshi Rubchinsky, whose wildly popular collections have inspired envy in brands across the industry. Mr. Rubchinsky shot his own portraits of his broody skater types in the Burberry collection, and his influence seemed to extend to the styling of the show itself, which was more contemporary and less fussy than it sometimes has been. Mr. Rubchinsky and Burberry also collaborated on several pieces, which had their debut in Mr. Rubchinsky's show in St. Petersburg, Russia, in June. Simone Rocha, Spring 2018. Tom Jameson for the New York Times. I'm trying to put myself in a situation where I'm looking at things fresh, Mr. Bailey said. It was a vintage trawl of proportions, styles, crystals and fabrics, including a bit too much plastic. But reduced to essential pieces, great outerwear, especially, like oversized Max and Harrington jackets, shown on men and women interchangeably, that fresh look made Burberry look fresh. It even looked cool. Distillation also worked in the favor of Simone Rocha, who had shown earlier in the afternoon. Last season, Ms. Rocha offered sturdy protection plush coats like suits of armor for women facing down the world. But this season, she stripped the armor away, and homed in on innocence and fragility. But innocence ends what's fragile, breaks. Ms. Roche knows that firsthand. She had been looking at dolls, including her own old China dolls, which she admitted with a laugh she used to send down the banister. They're all smashed up and glued back together. The smash hadn't yet come to her doll-like models, as they floated down the runway in quavering tiers of washed silk embroidery on glazed the skirts hand-embroidered with dolls and flowers. It made a moving and lovely scene, even as on the soundtrack, the country singer Skeeter Davis warbled, "Don't they know it's the end of the world? I know, it's a sad," Ms. Rocha said afterward. It just felt so fitting. A version of this review appears in print on September 18, 2017, on page A15, in the International New York Times.